everyone. I'm Abby Keebler.
I'm Katherine.
I'm Ashleigh Batista.
And I'm Monique.
We'll be presenting on gender and sexuality today.
So our issue focuses on one main question, and that is, how does gender and sexuality affect education in a democracy? And so for our answer, we have three main points. And so we stated, gender and sexuality issues directly relate to the discrepancy in the education of men versus women. So history, more often than not, has shown us that men are learning different things than women, which has often given the men an advantage over the women. And these issues also perpetuate gender stereotypes and rules, and they also emphasize heteronormativity. And heteronormativity is defined as the belief that heterosexuality and identifying as either man or woman is the natural and normal way of life.
So yeah, just to reiterate that, before we get into the entire presentation, we have a couple of definitions just to make sure that everyone is familiar with the different aspects of this topic. So the first one here is sex, as in biological sex. Merriam-Webster defines sex as either of the two major forms of individuals that occur in many species and that are distinguished respectively as male or female, especially on the basis of their reproductive organs and structures. So even just looking at this, you can see that the dictionary itself establishes a binary, either male or female, nothing in between. Whereas science has shown other things such as intersex and just an entire spectrum of sexual identity and biological sex that is not included in just the two binary options. Then there's gender, which Merriam-Webster defines as the behavioral, cultural, or psychological traits typically associated with sex or the expression of sex. So you might be able to look at someone's gender based on how they express it, as in like feminine traits, feminine clothing, masculine, etc., things like that. So it's not the biological aspect, it's the expression. And then heteronormativity, as Katie said earlier, is of, relating to, or based on the attitude that heterosexuality is the only normal and natural expression of sexuality. So if you're straight in like a male-female relationship, that's considered normal. And if you're anywhere else, then that's considered to be abnormal or maybe even unnatural. Now we're going to get into the history of gender biases in education. So I have a quote from an article written by Ward and Schneider. Heteronormativity functioned in the service of sustaining a patriarchal gender binary. So this is talking about throughout the history of education in America. And basically this means that the idea that it should be a man and a woman that are married, and like that's the relationship that should happen and that is meant to happen, actually functions in sustaining a gender binary world where the men are in charge. So it leads to the oppression of people on the LGBTQ plus spectrum, as well as the oppression of women. So how can that come into education? Heteronormativity comes up in education, especially like even from the colonial times, where women had to be, like they were only educated in the ways of being good wives and mothers. So they were taught to be like their mother, and they were taught to listen to their father. So the system assumed that women would just marry men and start families, and that that was their role in this world. Sexism comes into play as well. Educational opportunities that were given to men were not given to women for a very long time in this country. Higher education, the first women receiving college degrees in America did not receive them until the mid-1800s. A state university didn't even offer bachelor's degrees to women until 1855. But there are different curricula for men and females throughout history. Often women would be taught things like how to sew or how to cook or how to take care of children, whereas men would be guided more towards like technological jobs and how to run a government or take math courses and be a scientist. And this happened throughout science. Eventually, they decided, oh, let's let the women go to school too. But there is still this culturally ingrained idea that the reason that women should be educated is so that they can raise better children. so their children can be smarter and more prepared to enter society. So women were also viewed as not being capable of taking the same coursework as men. Moving forward, we actually begin to see legislation arise throughout, like in the later half of the 1900s, that tried to correct for gender bias as well, but it didn't always do its intended job. Looking at Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, that was in 1964, and it banned employment discrimination based on gender, but that's not the same thing as educational bias against gender. So women now, you can discriminate on hiring a female, but in school, females were still pushed towards classes that would prepare them for traditionally female roles instead of any job that they wanted, especially ones that were traditionally held by men. So then in 1972, we see Title IX of the Civil Rights Act passed, and that's the one that you hear about all over college campuses. So that bans gender discrimination in schools and any other institution that receives federal funds. So because of Title IX, we've made a lot of progress avoiding gender bias and discrimination, although we still have a little way to go.
So today there's still issues with gender bias and sexuality bias in schools, and we're going to take a look at some of those current issues. One of the first ones is teachers tend to tolerate some behaviors in boys they don't in girls. Like if a boy speaks out in class, he's being assertive or he's taking control, or girls can be seen as bossy. And teachers tend to give male students more praise and criticism than they give to females. I saw this quote which I thought was very interesting. It just says that each time students are seated or lined up by gender, teachers are affirming that girls and boys should be treated differently and they're separating them. Separation based on gender occurs in schools as well, which can be difficult for those who are transgender or not on the binary scale. Different cap and gown colors based on gender, it's difficult for students who are transgender or transitioning because they don't identify completely with one or the other gender. And separation based on gender, boys are more pushed to enroll in classes like math, science, technology, where girls still take English and like home ec, which then, because of this, women are underrepresented in professions like business leadership, engineering, science, technology, math, and medicine. Looking at the higher levels of education like college, campus housing, bathrooms and locker rooms, and official records and documents for colleges create issues for those students who are transgender or transitioning from one gender to the other, because there's not always a space for students to go to use the bathroom, or if they're changing their name, there's not, it's difficult for them to do that as well.
So where do we go from here, and how do we solve these gender sexuality issues within education? So we have a couple solutions next. So we have three main solutions to this issue. So we aim to dismantle gender stereotypes and biases. So of course, and like any of this, it's a group mindset kind of situation, and it cannot be achieved simply by just saying. And we need to take action, because typically like these like societal views and societal expectations are passed down from generation to generation. So it just starts with one generation, and once those like set of children grow up, they pass that new viewpoint on to their children. And then we also aim to remove the notion of superiority between genders, that oh, boys are better in this aspect and girls are better in this aspect. We want to create an even playing field where everyone can excel in what they feel is best for them and what best caters to their expression of themselves. And we also aim to diversify the presence of gender in media and note that sexuality is a sliding scale. So now more than ever, media is being used for multiple different platforms. And nowadays, children are using these platforms more and more at even younger ages. So we feel that that is a very good way to like reach that platform of children. So we really want to start like instituting these new solutions once children are in their formative years, in their childhood, further reinforce that as they're growing older into their teenage years, that they're equipped to handle situations when they're in their adult.
So how do we achieve these three solutions? As Monique stated, we really want to focus on instituting an open mindset in childhood. That's when, you know, children's minds are moldable, they're more open to learning. And so we have this equation that can be applied in the educational system. It's awareness plus discussion equals acceptance. So starting with awareness, gender and sexuality are not black and white as our society once perceived. And for people who are unaware of this, this can be a really difficult concept to grasp, a really difficult thing to understand, especially if you are cisgender and you're straight. And so early awareness can lead to easier understanding. If children are exposed to people of different gender expressions, different sexuality expressions, they'll see that as the norm. They won't see it as an abnormal thing, and they won't question it. And so there we can create an open mindset from the very beginning. And awareness is the first step to understanding. And once you understand something, it's easier to accept it, which is our ultimate goal, acceptance of all individuals, no matter how they identify. And I found this quote. It was from an article talking about heteronormativity and why it's bad and why we need to start getting rid of it. And it says, assuming that people only identify as either male or female is incorrect. And this actually occurs a lot of times. A lot of people are simply unaware of the spectrum. They're unaware of different forms of expression and different identities. And so by just bringing awareness and bringing in a discussion about these different identities, that's when we can start accepting all these differences. So the next part of the equation was discussion. And so once you are aware of all these issues, aware of all these gender and sexuality topics, you're probably going to have a lot of questions. And that's expected, because with discussion creates unity. So we pictured having a classroom setting where students can feel comfortable to talk to their peers, talk to their teachers, talk to people who maybe identify as something different than them, where they can openly ask questions and they can learn about these topics. And once you are discussing with your peers and you're learning together, that's when you can become united. And we also want discussion to be a main part, because we don't want gender and sexuality to be taboo topics. We want these issues to be easily discussed because they affect a lot of people. And finally, acceptance is our main goal. For all of our solutions to be reached, for gender stereotypes to be dismantled, for better representation in the media, and for equality among all gender identities, you have to be accepting. And so that's what awareness and discussion bring about, acceptance. However, we understand that, you know, especially with parents who are maybe a little more closed-minded and they're passing those beliefs on to their children, acceptance may not always be a feasible goal among students. And so tolerance, at the very least, is what we strive for. And another quote I found, which actually was by a woman who was writing about mandatory gender and sexuality studies in higher education, stated that understanding gender identity different than your own often leads to a broader understanding and appreciation of humanity. And that's really all we want. We just want people to recognize that there are different forms of expression, that it's not weird to express yourself differently. It is completely normal. It is completely natural. And we want that to be normal. We want diversity among all individuals to be accepted. So just to mention a couple drawbacks, we realized that the solution may be a little abstract and a little idealized. So we have three concrete programs, I guess you could call them. And so we want to start with the educators. So this would be giving teachers a way and showing them how to talk to students about these topics, because a lot, they can sometimes feel uncomfortable or unsafe. And if students are not comfortable with what they're learning about, then no progress will be made. And so teaching educators how to create a safe environment to have these discussions and to teach these topics is the first step. And then second is also gender neutrality. And so that includes like gender neutral bathrooms, which we even have here on our own campus, and enforcing that in public institutions. And then that also includes etiquette and speech. So making sure that teachers are referring to their class as friends, not more so boys and girls. In our research, we actually found a documentary on Sweden where they have gender-neutral kindergartens, and that's what the teachers did. They referred to their students as gender-neutral. They had gender-neutral toys. where they didn't have anything like princesses or cars or things that would typically be characterized as feminine or masculine. And so enforcing those practices in our own schools can make more students, even those who maybe don't identify as typical male or female, feel comfortable and safe in their school. And then lastly, we want to make gender and sexuality mandatory education for all students. It should be mandatory just like a PE class or a sex ed class, because these are topics that relate to everyone. No matter if you're cisgender, if you're straight, whatever, this topic relates to you. And so by educating people, making them aware that these things, making them aware of gender and sexuality, of the spectrums, of the the definitions that come with it, and just educating them, that can help them to understand each other and again, bring them to accept it, and hopefully will lead to a more open-minded society.
Are there any questions?
Okay.